If you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 3. Acts, chapter 3. And I want to talk to you about raising expectations in 2017. Acts, chapter 3, raising expectations in 2017. You might notice that in your bulletin this morning, there is a one-year Bible reading schedule. And, you know, it's not so often that the new year happens to fall on a Sunday, but it's the first day of the week, it's the first day of the month, it's the first day of the new year. And maybe you have never read through the Bible. This might be a good year to decide that you're going to read all the way through the scripture in a year. You know, it really only takes about 15 or 20 minutes of reading every day at the most to read through the Bible in a whole year. Some of you have never done that, and maybe this is your year to do it. Some of you have read a lot of some portions of the Bible, but haven't read any of other portions of the Bible, and you need to know what the whole Bible says. Jesus said, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So maybe you want to make it your goal. Maybe it's been a while since you've read through the Bible. And you can use this schedule. You can follow it starting today. Just tick it off. There's also an app that goes along with this particular Bible reading schedule. And so you can download the app to your telephone, and it'll send you the daily readings to your phone or to your iPad or your computer. And you can read that way if you prefer. And the information for that app is printed right there on that Bible reading schedule. But why not make it a goal to read through the Word of God together and to just let the Word of God dwell in us richly in this new year? All right, let's talk about Acts chapter 3, and let's talk about raising expectations in 2017. Acts chapter 3, and beginning in verse 1, Scripture says, one day, would you say that with me?
One day.
One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, 3 p.m. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting, would you say that word with me? Expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver or gold, I do not have. But what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and leaping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. Let's pray and invite the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Lord, thank you for this new morning. Thank you for this new week, this new month, for this new year. Lord, we've come this morning to present ourselves to you at the very start. Lord, in the very first hours of this new year. Father, for every person who's begging for a fresh start, Lord, I pray that your grace would come, Lord. Father, I pray that you would just saturate us with your presence this morning, drench us. And I pray, Father, that you'd fill our hearts to overflowing with faith. If your heart agrees with that, would you say amen and amen? I have a question from the Lord for you this morning. What are you expecting in 2017? What are you expecting? What good things are you expecting to happen to you this year? What good things are you expecting to happen in your family? What good things are you expecting to happen in your career, in your health? What are you expecting to happen in your walk with the Lord? What miracles are you expecting from the Lord? I believe that there are times that the Lord has to raise the level of our expectations so that he can raise the level of our faith. He has to take us from expecting nothing to expecting something so that we can receive everything from him. In the Gospels, there were numerous occasions when Jesus asked people, "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked the lame man lying by the pool of Bethesda. The Bible said that he had lain there for years and years. And Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" Numerous times he asked blind people who called out to him for help, "What do you want me to do for you?" Did you ever stop to think how ironic that was? First of all, it was obvious what they wanted, wasn't it? The lame man wanted to walk. The blind man wanted to see. And Jesus already knew what they wanted before he even asked them the question. And he already knew what the Father was about to do. So why ask the question? Was Jesus toying with them? No, he's not like that. I believe Jesus asked the question because he wanted to raise the level of their expectations and thereby raise the level of their faith. Jesus wanted them to articulate their need because in the process of articulating their need, their expectations were raised. Jesus wanted them to ask him to do the impossible thing that they really wanted him to do. "Lord, I want to walk. Lord, I want to see." You know, sometimes if we're honest, we bunt in our prayers, don't we? Instead of asking God for the impossible miracle that we really want, we ask God for something less. "Lord, give me the patience to endure this affliction." No. When Jesus asked the lame man, "What do you want me to do for you?" the lame man didn't say, "Lord, give me grace to endure my lameness." He said, "Lord, I want to walk." The blind man didn't say, "Lord, give me grace to endure this darkness." He said, "Lord, I want to see." As we begin this new year, I believe that Jesus has his hand extended to us and he is asking us, "What do you want me to do for you?" I believe that he wants us specifically to ask him to do the impossible thing. I believe he wants to lift our expectations and thereby lift our faith. "What do you want me to do for you?" Let's not bunt on the question. Let's not ask God to do something less because we think it's easier for him. Is anything too hard for the Lord? You know what I want God to do for us in 2017? I want him to help us move into phase two on time and debt-free. I want him to help us finish both levels, the upper and the lower level, by May 31st. I want him to open the windows of heaven and pour out the 800,000 we need to finish the sanctuary and the other 800,000 we need to finish the lower level. You know, it's interesting in the Sermon on the Mount, right after Jesus says to us, "Your heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask," right after he says that, he goes on to say, "Ask and seek and knock," an escalating pattern of petitioning God. He also taught us parables so that we would pray and never give up. God wants us to ask him. I also find as I read about Jesus that when he heard the blind man articulate his need, Jesus' heart was moved with compassion to answer. You know, that's something as a dad that I can understand. There's something about your child asking you to meet a need that's just absolutely irresistible. Jesus said, if your earthly father's being imperfect, if your son asks you for bread, would you give him a stone? No, never. God has just programmed it into our hearts to respond to our children's needs because that's His Father's heart. God wants to raise the level of our expectations and thereby raise the level of our faith. And that brings us to the story of the lame man in Acts chapter 3. Day by day, worshipers were going into the temple, passing by a pitiful sight at a beautiful gate. The beautiful gate was the portal that led from the outermost court of the temple, the court of the Gentiles, into the inner precincts where only Jewish people could go. According to the Jewish historian Josephus, this was the largest and most exquisite of all the temple gates. It's remarkable that in a temple complex that was entirely gilded with gold and encrusted with precious jewels, that these particular gates stood out among it all as being beautiful. On the other side of the beautiful gate were signs written in Greek and Latin, "Non-Jews do not enter under penalty of death." Roman rulers and soldiers were not permitted through the beautiful gate. Greek visitors were not permitted through the beautiful gate. Eastern astrologers, spiritual seekers were not permitted through the beautiful gate. Neither were the lame, nor the blind, nor the bleeding, nor men who were emasculated, nor the sick. Just outside the beautiful gate was a pitiful sight, a poor beggar. A man who was crippled from birth. A man who had lived for over 40 years, never once enjoying the independence of being able to go wherever he wanted, whenever he wanted, on his own two legs. A man who never enjoyed the pride and fulfillment of making his own way in the world. A man who was unable to have or care for a family of his own. The crippled man sat day after day, staring at the beautiful gate, but he was never permitted to see and experience the wonders that lay on the other side. He never got to see the court of women. He never got to see the offering receptacles in the temple treasury that were shaped like trumpets. He never got to see Solomon's porch where the teachers taught and debated the law. He never got to see the court of Israel where the whole men went to worship. He never got to see the open door into the court of priests where, wearing all white, they offered sacrifices on the brass altar, and beyond that, the gilded facade of the temple sanctuary containing the most holy place that was decorated with a golden grapevine all around encrusted with precious jewels. Outside of the beautiful gate, he could hear the celebrating during the Feast of Tabernacles. He could see the light from the great menorah, but he couldn't participate in the dancing and the revelry. Day by day, he sat on his beggar's mat, chanting his beggar's chant, raising his beggar's hand, a pitiful sight at a beautiful gate. Something occurred to me as I thought about this man. Luke makes it clear that this was this man's habitual spot. Like beggars all over the world, this was his turf. He was carried there every day. That means that this was not the first day that Peter and John had walked past this man. In fact, he was over 40, which means that Jesus had walked by him many times as well. On the day that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary in Bethlehem, this man was a crippled child of 8 years old or more. He was already begging outside the beautiful gate on the day that 12-year-old Jesus confounded the teachers of the law in Solomon's porch. He was begging outside the beautiful gate on the day that Jesus stood up and cried with a loud voice, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me shall not stumble in darkness, but shall have the light of life." He was there outside of the beautiful gate on the great day of the feast when Jesus stood up and cried, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, will have rivers of living water flowing from him." He was outside of the beautiful gate on the day that the temple guards rushed in to arrest Jesus. And then they came out a few hours later with no prisoner because Jesus' teaching had so overwhelmed them that they forgot to arrest him. He was begging outside of the beautiful gate on the day when Jesus braided a whip and drove out the peddlers and the money changers. He was there outside of the beautiful gate on the day that Jesus sat by the offering receptacles and watched a widow throw in her last 2 cents. Day after day, how many times had Jesus passed by this pitiful sight at a beautiful gate? He was begging outside the beautiful gate on the day that shouts of celebration rang out across the Kidron Valley from the Mount of Olives. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He was there outside the beautiful gate on the day of preparation for the Passover while Jesus was being tried at a place called the Pavement, and when he was mocked in the soldier's fort called Antonio that sits just next to the temple. He was outside of the beautiful gate when they whipped Jesus. He was outside of the beautiful gate when the crowd shouted, "Crucify him." He was outside of the beautiful gate when they led him away. He was outside of the beautiful gate on the day of preparation at the time of the evening sacrifice when God's own Passover lamb gave his life for the sins of the world and said, "It is finished." He was there when the sun grew dark and when the earth shook and when the temple curtain tore in two. He was begging outside of the beautiful gate on the afternoon of the first day of the week when Jesus appeared to 2 disciples on the road to Emmaus and then appeared to them in the upper room. He was there outside of the beautiful gate on the day that Jesus' disciples came back to the temple. Day after day, for 10 days, 120 of Jesus' followers walked past him in the morning and walked past him in the night, going in and out of the temple to pray. He was outside of the beautiful gate on the day that there was the sound of a tornadic wind in Jerusalem. And a little while later, Jesus' followers rushed past him with a huge mob shouting in foreign languages. He was there when 3,120 came back out of the gate and headed down to the Pool of Siloam for a baptism. Day after day, the apostles, accompanied by a few thousand of Jesus' followers, passed by the pitiful sight at a beautiful gate, day after day, until one day. Beloved, may the grace of God fill your heart. May the love of God fill your heart with hope. May the word of God fill you with faith. May the spirit of God fill you with holy expectation. One day was his last day as a beggar. One day was his last day as a crippled, broken, impotent, dependent, excluded man. Day after day, Jesus passed by. Day after day, the apostles passed by. But one day was his day. One day was his day for a life-changing encounter with God. One day was his day to be healed. One day was his day to be transformed, for everything to come together. God wants to awaken faith and hope in someone's heart here this morning for what is possible one day in 2017. Who knows what a day might bring forth? I want to share 5 observations with you quickly about that one day. 5 observations quickly about that one day. Observation number 1. A miracle happened one day because Peter and John prayed every day. One day, Peter and John went to the temple to pray at the time of evening prayer. That was 3 o'clock in the afternoon. You see, Peter and John were in the habit of prayer. They had a dynamic prayer life and a disciplined prayer life. Some of us have discipline without dynamism, and some of us have dynamism without discipline. They had both. That's good preaching right there. You don't even know how good it is. That was good. They had set times for prayer. They prayed in the morning. They prayed in the afternoon. They prayed in the evening. They prayed without ceasing. They prayed when it was hot. They prayed when it was cold. They prayed at church. They prayed at home. They prayed in public. They prayed alone. Day by day, while the crippled man begged outside, they prayed inside, and that's why one day finally came. I have a word of encouragement for all the praying dads and praying moms here. Keep on praying every day, because one day is on the way. I have a word for all the praying grandpas and grandmas. I have a word for all the praying spouses, for all the praying kids, for all the praying friends. You keep on praying every day, because one day is on the way for the people that you love. And it's going to be in 2017. Come on. Five observations about one day. Observation number two. A miracle happened one day because Peter and John walked in agreement. They walked in unity every day. Even though Peter takes the lead in this story, even though he does all the talking, Luke goes out of his way to make sure that we know that it was Peter and John walking together. Actually, Acts chapter 3 and 4 is a whole day full of miracles. And what's interesting is that this whole day of miracles is bookended by a powerful statement of the unity of the church at the beginning and at the end of the day. You see, supernatural power is released when there is unity in God's church. That's the message of Jesus in Matthew 18. Walking in agreement, walking in unity with one another is vitally important, because what is at stake, Jesus says, is our ability to bind and loose. Amen. I tell you the truth, if two of you agree, whatever you ask for will be done by your Father. And whatever you bind will be bound, and whatever you loose will be loosed. Jesus says here that every matter on earth is established by two or three witnesses. So here's what it takes. All it takes is two of us, just two of us, walking in agreement in Jesus' name, and Jesus himself comes and partners with those two and makes the third witness, and the miracle is released. That's why we can't afford to be out of alignment with one another. That's why we can't afford to be in disunity and disharmony. That's why we can't afford to stay offended with one another. Now listen to me. Unity does not mean uniformity. Does it mean that we all have to look alike and act alike? That would be boring. It doesn't mean unanimity. It doesn't mean that we all agree on everything, but it means we agree to get along. We have to agree together every day so that others can get there one day. Five observations about one day. Observation number three. A miracle happened one day because Peter and John looked through the eyes of Jesus. In Jesus' day, there were three set times for prayer. Sunrise, in the middle of the day, and at sunset. In the morning and in the evening, most people prayed alone at home or with their families. But the big time for public prayer was 3:00 in the afternoon. That was the time of the evening sacrifice. When the trumpet sounded, everything in Jerusalem screeched to a halt. As many people as could make it up to the temple would go up to the temple to pray. Those who couldn't make it all the way to the temple would stop in the streets where they were, and they would turn and they would face the temple and pray. This was also the time when people gave alms to the poor, either in the temple or out on the streets where they were. That's why Jesus tells us in Matthew 6 in the Sermon on the Mount, when you give to the needy, don't make a show of it in the streets at the sound of the trumpets. The crippled man had a primo spot for begging. He was just outside of the beautiful gate. When he saw Peter and John, he broke into his usual beggar's chant. It says he was asking over and over for money. Without any doubt, Peter and John had passed this man before, but this day something was different. This day they gazed intently on him. And when they looked at him, they saw something that they had not seen before. They didn't see what the man was. They saw what he was about to become. They saw what God was about to do in his life. You know, that's how Jesus looked at people. When he looked at them, he saw what God had planned for their future. Isn't that how Jesus saw Peter and John when he first met them on the shores of Galilee? He didn't see crude fishermen. He saw catchers of men. He saw miracle workers. He saw apostles. He saw the founding members of a new world religion that would dominate human history to the very end. He saw the patriarchs of the new covenant. He saw men whose names would be etched forever in the foundation of the new Jerusalem alongside the names of Jacob's 12 sons. Would you have seen all that when you looked at Peter and John? I want to tell you, God is gazing on somebody in this place on this New Year's Day. God's eyes are fixed on you, and he sees not the messes of your past or the messes of your present, but he sees the promises of your future. He sees what you are about to look like in 2017, and he wants you to know you're looking good. You came to church today because you thought it was Sunday, but you didn't realize that today is one day. Beloved, there is a godly prophetic gaze that gives life. When you look at someone and you see not the brokenness of their past nor the despair of their present, but the brightness of his future in Christ. I would submit to you that the fruit of Peter and John's daily prayers was not the power to heal. That power had already been bestowed on them by Jesus. The fruit of their daily prayers was the ability to see in that moment what God was about to do. Let's pray every day. Listen, if you've received Christ, the Spirit of God is dwelling inside of you. You have already received the commission. You've already received the authority. You already have the goods. What you need is to pray every day so that God will give you those eyes of Jesus to see what he's about to do. Five observations about one day. Observation number four, you doing all right? You're looking pretty good. You're not looking too sleepy. Number four, a miracle happened one day because Peter and John were nonprofit prophets every day. Here's how we know that Peter and John were true Pentecostals. They had no money. I want you to know that we are Pentecostal and we are following in their footsteps. I want you to think about this. Peter and John were the administrators of a very large general fund given by the new believers. People were selling their properties, and they were giving all the money to the church. That was a lot of money. But I want you to notice that Peter and John were not carrying any money on them. Peter and John followed in the footsteps of Jesus, who never carried any money on him either. Unlike the Pharisees, Peter and John weren't interested in impressing people by making a big show of their almsgiving. Instead, like Jesus, they were aware that they were in possession of something far more precious than money that they could dispense at will. What they possessed was the mighty name of Jesus. What they possessed was living faith in that name. What they possessed was delegated authority from the Son of God to save and heal and deliver. What they possessed was the dynamite power of the Holy Spirit inside of them. Who needs money when you're carrying that? Notice also that Peter and John refused to take any personal glory for the healing miracle. The people look at them astonished. And Peter said to them, "Don't look at us as if it were by our power and godliness that this man is walking. Jesus has done this." They didn't even take credit for being men of great faith. They said, "It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has given healing to this man." Pastor Nick said it the best ever. He said, "There might be holy, Christian men, but there is no such thing as a Christian holy man. The miracle came completely from Jesus, and they were careful to give Jesus all of the glory. Beloved, we need more non-profit prophets today. We need a new generation to rise that wants to make Jesus famous rather than getting famous. You know, I want to talk to the millennials. You guys, you get beat up. They say the worst things about you. I see so much promise. You know, millennials, you are so creative. You are out of the box thinkers. And I want to challenge you, young adults, teenagers, do it better than my generation did it. Why don't you become the Samuels that replace the gluttonous old Elis? Rather than to make a name for ourselves in the world, let's make it our goal to make the name of Jesus famous in the world. Let's make John the Baptist creed our creed. He must increase and I must decrease. Because Peter and John were non-profit prophets, every day the crippled man got his one day. Five observations about one day. Observation number five, worship team, you can come help me. A miracle happened one day because Peter and John raised expectations. And beloved, listen, because here is our word for 2017. The crippled man probably expected nothing when Peter and John walked by. After all, beggars all over the world are accustomed to being ignored. And these guys had walked past this man many times and had never given him a thing. Anywhere in the world, it is street smarts 101. Never make eye contact with a beggar. Don't look his way. Don't acknowledge him, don't smile at him, don't nod. To make eye contact is to get involved. When he saw Peter and John coming, he likely expected nothing. Beloved, I want to tell you, when the world looks at us, more than often, they expect nothing. When they look at the church, they see an institution with nothing to offer anymore. The reason is because we've pursued being well-rounded citizens of the world rather than pursuing the burning presence of God in our lives. But Peter and John looked at that crippled man with that prophetic gaze that brings life. And Peter said, "Look at us. Feast your eyes on this baby." And when the man looked at them, suddenly expectation was born in his heart. He expected something, Luke says. They moved him from expecting nothing to expecting something. And when they moved him to expecting something, he was in position to get everything from God. Beloved, when you expect nothing from God, you get nothing from God. Remember, Jesus told the parable of the 10 talents. The unfaithful servant got exactly what he expected. He expected his talent to earn nothing, and it earned nothing. He expected to be treated harshly by the king, and he was treated harshly by the king. He expected for the king to take away what he had, and the king did. But the servant who expected something got everything. Oh, that God would make us people of everyday prayer. That he would make us people who walk in agreement. Not that we agree on everything, but we agree to get along every day. That he would give us eyes to see others like Jesus does every day. That he would make us non-profit prophets every day. Then we could say, "Look at us. Feast your eyes on this," and we could move, if we gave them something worth looking at, we could move them from expecting nothing to expecting something. And if we can move them to expecting something, then we can put them in position to receive everything from God. Very quickly, three things Jesus does, and we're done. Three things Jesus does. Number one, Jesus makes walkers. Dr. Luke elaborates a little bit on the nature of this miracle. Being a doctor, he was interested in it. The man had been crippled from his mother's womb. He was not crippled because of a trauma he experienced. He was not crippled because he had an accident or an injury. He was born with a congenital defect that rendered him crippled. He was born that way, but he didn't have to stay that way. What does that mean for us? Well, for one thing, it means that Jesus is able to heal the things that have been broken about you for as long as you can remember. It doesn't matter how long it's been broken. It doesn't matter how badly it's broken. Jesus is able to heal it in one day. Jesus is able to heal you instantly. The crippled man was over 40 years old. He had never once walked. Dr. Luke understood all the implications of that. It wasn't just his feet and his ankles that needed healing. It was his calves. It was his knees. It was his thighs. It was his glutes. It was his lower and upper abdominals, joints and ligaments and bones. All of it immediately received supernatural quickening. Jesus is able to heal you completely. Not only did the crippled man receive supernatural strength, he also received supernatural ability. Think about it. All the abilities of balance and motion that he had never learned instantly came to him. How many of you have children? Let me see your hands if you have kids. How many of you remember when your kids were learning how to walk? Do you remember the whole process? It took months, didn't it? First, they would get up on all fours and they would rock back and forth. And then after they did that for a while, they would gingerly put their hand on something and attempt to stand and fall. And, you know, that's the stage in parenting where you're constantly going, right? You know, because you don't want the baby to fall and bang their head. And eventually they master standing, and then they let go and they venture to take their first step. It takes a little time, doesn't it, to achieve balance and motion and to learn how to walk. This man never went through any of those stages, and yet all of that ability was given to him on the spot. I have a word for someone for 2017. God is going to instantly give you the ability to do some things you have never done before and you have never learned how to do. He's going to give you the ability supernaturally to master them. Beloved, listen to me. The Bible says that God is able to save to the uttermost those who come to him through Jesus. That means he doesn't just make you a little better. That means he makes you better all the way. He makes broken people into walkers. The crippled man expected only a hand out. What he got was a hand up. God is not into handouts. He's into giving hand ups. He's into giving us the unction to function in life. Peter grabbed that same right hand that he had used to beg for 40 years, and he pulled the man up by that hand in the name of Jesus. Listen, Jesus came to give you more than a handout to help you get by. Jesus came to give you a hand up so you can walk. Three things Jesus does. He makes walkers. Secondly, Jesus makes worshipers. When the crippled man was made whole, his first response was to worship God. He didn't run to show his family what had happened to him. He didn't run to show his friends. He didn't run off on a book tour, go on the talk show circuit. He began leaping and jumping and praising God right through the beautiful gates into the temple where he had never been. Beloved, listen to me. Jesus wants to touch you, and he wants to usher you into a place of worship where you have never been before. When brokenness is turned into wholeness, that's when we bring glory and honor to God. When the shattered image of God is restored in us, that's when we bring him worship. Jesus makes possible what was previously impossible. We were shut out from the presence of God, but Jesus has opened wide the doors of the temple, and now we can go all the way in to the Holy of Holies and bask in the beauty of his presence. Three things Jesus does. He makes walkers, he makes worshipers, and finally, Jesus makes witnesses. How smart is God? Did you know that God is his own public relations strategist? God is his own press agent. At the time of the evening prayers, this healed man came jumping and leaping and twirling and shouting into the temple, and it was packed with people that were there to pray. And everybody looked and said, "Hey, I know that guy. That's the crippled beggar that sat outside of the beautiful gate." Peter preached a sermon, and over 5,000 people accepted Jesus as their Savior in one day. Beloved, may God give you grace. May he open your heart to see the possibility of one day in 2017. I want to tell you, I prophesy to you in Jesus' name, your one day is on the way. One day is going to be your last day stuck in dysfunctional relationships. One day is going to be your last day in dependence and codependence. One day is going to be your last day in depression. One day is going to be your last day in anxiety. One day is going to be your last day in self-defeating thinking. One day is going to be your last day stuck in addiction. One day is going to be your last day stuck in financial hardship. One day is going to be your last day in pain. Oh, people are going to come. They're going to say, "I remember you. I remember you. You were the one that couldn't get it together. You were the one that couldn't keep a job. You're the one whose marriage is falling apart. I remember you. What happened to you?" One day. Come on, I want you to say it with me. One day. One day, one day. Come on, listen, you say this. My one day is on its way. My one day is on its way. In Jesus' name. Silver and gold I don't have, but such as I have, I give to you in the name of Jesus. Get up and walk. Come on, give him praise. Come on, lift up a good praise to him.